It's been 25 years since a new model full-size Ford Bronco was on sale, but that streak's over. The Bronco is back, and it's got a bone to pick with off-road rivals like the Jeep Wrangler. But which Bronco is right for you? Do you go with something like the two-door, manual, smaller motor, or do you go for the big boy? The four-door with the larger motor and an automatic transmission. That's what we're gonna find out today. Let's get into it. Starting with the two-door, this is the black diamond trim, one up from the base. And so in addition to the base features where you get reflector LED headlights and your Bronco spelled out in white on the grill, you now have this steel front bumper with two recovery points and a bash plate down low. You also, as standard on the Bronco, have these sight markers which tell you where your front tires are, very valuable when you're out on the trail. On the side here, we've got this set of 17-inch steel wheels in black. I love that look, wrapped in General Grabber all-terrain tires. Behind the front tires, you've got a set of rock sliders here for underbody protection. Notable is that the mirrors are not mounted on the doors because you can remove the doors on the Bronco, so they put them up here just behind the hood. This one has the optional roof rack. The hard top is standard on the two-door model, and this keypad here, where you can leave the key in your car, is an accessory on the vehicle. Stepping back, I wanna just pop open the fuel door for a sec to point out the fact that, one, this says capless fueling, which I love, and also there's a little Easter egg here showing you the three previous generations of Bronco. At the back are some incandescent taillights, two recovery points down here, a full-size spare mounted on the swing-out tailgate with a hydraulic gas strut to make it easier. Moving now to the four-door. Now, this is the first edition model, which was limited to 7,000 production units. All have been sold out. However, you can replicate most of what you see on this truck right here in the other trims. So we've got this modular steel bumper with a brush guard now. And instead of the reflector LEDs, we now have projector headlights with these cool signatures on the first edition. And this one has a gloss black grille with a different insert than the matte black grille in the two-door. The first edition comes equipped with the Sasquatch package, and that means we have 17-inch beadlock capable wheels in gloss black, and they're wrapped in 35-inch Goodyear Wrangler tires. But you're not gonna see Wrangler anywhere on these tires because Ford would want that. That's their main competitor. So they worked with Goodyear to just say, Goodyear, Goodyear. Moving back, we're now upgraded to gloss black mirror housings with LED spotlights integrated within. Down low, we still have rock sliders like the Black Diamond, and the four-door comes standard with the soft top, but here we have the optional hard top with removable panels. At the back of the first edition are LED taillights and yet another full-size spare, though this is more impressive because it's so much heavier. This Black Diamond two-door has the standard 2.3-liter turbocharged four-cylinder that makes 300 horsepower and 325 pound-feet of torque. It's paired with a 7-speed manual gearbox with a first crawler gear, or you can choose the 10-speed automatic. 19 combined MPG for this one, and a part-time four-wheel drive system is standard. You can upgrade to the 2.7-liter twin-turbocharged V6 that makes 330 horsepower and 415 pound-feet of torque, but that engine only comes with the 10-speed automatic gearbox. It gets 17 combined MPG with the Sasquatch package, and it still has the part-time four-wheel drive system as standard. We're inside the two-door Black Diamond, and it's looking a little dark in here. Fortunately, it's really easy to take off these hardtop panels. We've got three latches for each one. One, two, and three. And then one lever to pull, and it pops right off. In the Black Diamond trim, we've got marine-grade vinyl seats with blue contrast stitching. A Bronco is embossed on the seat back. In that first edition model, these are swapped out for leather and vinyl seats, and they're 10-way power seats, whereas these are 6-way manual. You've got Bronco here on the dashboard, spelled out and sort of recessed into the dash, along with two grab handles on either side, in addition to this grab handle right here on the center console. There is a leather shift boot around your manual transmission. Your 2-speed transfer case controller is here, along with your go over any terrain modes, GOAT for short, and you've got 7 different drive modes there. There's some soft touch material on top of the center console. Below that, you'll find your 2 automatic power windows, along with your power door mirror controls. Single zone of climate control here. You get 2 zones of automatic climate control in that first edition. Up top, we've got an 8-inch touchscreen infotainment as standard in the Bronco. It has Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. That one has the upgraded 12-inch screen, and it does look like a huge difference. Both are running the Sync 4 infotainment system. It's a very good system, easy to navigate. And then up top on the dashboard, we have your electronic rear locking differential button here, traction control. And then on the first edition, it adds to that with a front locking differential, a trail turn assist control, and a front sway bar disconnect. Further up on the dash is a place to mount a camera, say a GoPro if you wanted to record your off-road adventures. And on the first edition, you're gonna find two more USB ports there. In front of the driver, we've got an 8-inch digital gauge cluster, and that's on both of these two vehicles here, and an analog speedometer off to the left. This gauge cluster is reconfigurable somewhat. The only thing I don't like about it on the manual equipped vehicle especially is that the tachometer can't really expand anymore, so it stays somewhat small. You gotta really be looking for where to shift. Both vehicles get a leather-wrapped steering wheel. It's heated on the first edition model there, and you have additional buttons on the steering wheel of the first edition for your adaptive cruise control system and your lane keep feature. This one doesn't have blind spot monitoring. It does have a wide-angle mirror portion up there, and it doesn't have rear cross traffic alerts or the 360-degree camera that you get on the first edition. And both this and the first edition both get 6 pre-wired auxiliary switches for your accessories. On my way back, I should mention that because this seat material is waterproof and because you have these drain plugs here in the floor, you can spray down this cabin if you get it all muddy during your off-road adventures. I'm gonna climb on back and slide the seat back to my driving position at 6 feet tall. You can see my knees still clear with a couple inches of knee room, and the foot pockets are nice and tall so I can slide my feet under and decrease that knee angle. My head clears the roof with plenty of space, and these seats are actually super comfortable. Nice and plush. I feel like I have enough room and there's enough space between me and this passenger. Two adults could definitely sit back here pretty easily. And as far as accommodations go, each passenger has a USB port and a cup holder. In the back of the Bronco two-door, you'll find 22 cubic feet of space with the seats up. You can fold them down pretty easily and you expand to 52 cubic feet of space. In the four-door, you have 38 cubic feet to start with the seats up and 82 cubic feet of space with them folded down. And both trucks get a DC outlet off to the right. In summary, I love the cabin of this new Ford Bronco. It's got little touches to make it feel special while also having all the convenience features you would need. If it's me, I'm taking the convenience of the four-door though. We're starting at the wheel of the four-door with the 2.7-liter twin-turbo V6. And let me tell you, 330 horsepower is acceptable, but 415 pound-feet of torque is a lot. This thing gets moving, and even on these oversized tires, there's no aspect of it that feels underpowered. With the Sasquatch package, it has Bilstein monotube shocks with reservoirs in the front, and the suspension is definitely set up for faster, higher impact off-roading. And so on road, you feel the bumps a little bit and it unsettles you somewhat, but it's really not bad. It's actually a very good ride quality for the capability of this truck. The transmission is also excellent in the smoothness with which it moves between gears. You don't really even notice it, and that's even if you put your foot all the way down. It kicks down promptly, the turbos spool up quickly, they get you the power that you need. Honestly, the only downside to the Bronco as a daily driver is going to be some added wind noise. Whether you have the soft top or with the hard top, when you can take off the roof panels, that means there are more nooks and crannies for wind to get in here. And so you are hearing that, especially at highway speeds. Now, we're not doing anything super technical off-road today, but I have done that in this four-door with the Sasquatch. And let me tell you, it's super impressive. First of all, the suspension truly comes alive. It's basically a desert runner. This thing has got speed and it has the stability when you're going at speed over really intense bumps and bruises. I even took a little jump in it and it did just fine. And then in the low speed technical stuff, having the disconnecting sway bar and the locking differentials, I mean, you could take this very far off-road. Honestly, anywhere you want to go should be capable in the Bronco. Now let's hop over to the two-door and see how that feels. Now hopping behind the wheel of the two-door with the 2.3-liter single-turbo four-cylinder, and this is a much more defined turbocharging experience where the boost really comes on at a certain point, but there is ample pep to this engine. I experienced it in the Ranger most recently, but here with more torque, more power, it's very well suited to the Bronco. And this manual transmission is excellent. Apart from that one thing I mentioned about the tachometer being kind of small, the gearbox itself has very defined throws. You know when you're notching into each gear. And without those oversized tires that you have in the Forder with the Sasquatch package, you're not getting that hum. And so there's a little less noise coming into this cabin. Of course, you still have a bit of that wind noise that trickle in through the hardtop panels, but it's not bad. And as we prepare for our off-roading, we're gonna wanna choose the right drive mode. And so in addition to the four on-road modes, you get sport in this with the smaller engine, you don't have sport in that one, you get three off-road modes, mud and ruts, sand and rock crawl. Of course, if you have the bigger engine, you also add an off-road sport mode. It's really just called Baja. We're gonna start out in mud and ruts. Now here off-road, I'm gonna move the transfer case to four-wheel drive high, quick transition, and our four-driven wheels giving us the confidence off-road. And though we don't have the reservoirs of that Sasquatch package, these monotubes do an excellent job filtering out the harshest little bumps. And now, even though we don't have the beefier Bilstein suspension from the Sasquatch package, this two-door has an excellent breakover angle in addition to superb approach and departures. Plus, this crawler gear means that when we go into four-wheel drive low and we lift this up and pull it down into the crawl gear, it can make its way over obstacles very easily. Just optimizing the low-end torque and creeping up and over challenging terrain. Well, the new Ford Bronco is clearly a hoot to drive off-road, and it's excellent on-road with that independent front suspension. It's very well suited to daily driving, and then you can, of course, go have some fun on the weekends off-road. But is it the best option among these off-road-oriented full-size SUVs? You, of course, have the cross-town rival, cross-state rival, rather, the Jeep Wrangler. And the Wrangler and the Bronco both start in the $30,000 territory. However, the Wrangler Sport comes with a lot less standard features than you're getting in the Ford Bronco. It foregoes things like air conditioning as standard in the Wrangler. And this one is just very nicely equipped. I think the ride quality is better in this vehicle. I think the cabin is nicer to look at. I think the exterior is cooler. So if it's between the Wrangler and this, for me, I'm leaning more towards the Bronco. But what about other off-road rivals? Well, you've got the new Land Rover Defender. But even in 90 form, the two-door version of that, that one's $47,770. So a lot more expensive to start. And then if you want the four-door, if you want the V6 version of that one, it quickly gets into the 60s, much like the first edition Bronco four-door with the Sasquatch that we have. But that one's fully kitted out. The Defender, you can really add on a lot and make it very expensive. You've got the Toyota 4Runner, and that's gonna start a little more expensive than the Bronco. And I think at this point, it's just very much outdated in a lot of different ways. I think the new Bronco is in a sweet spot. It's got retro styling, it's got a very accommodating cabin, excellent ride quality, and incredible capability off-road. It's my pick of the off-road segment right now. From the Wrangler to the Defender to the 4Runner, this just rises above the herd for me. If you want to learn any more about the vehicles I mentioned, click the link in the description below or go to autobytel.com. Thank you guys so much for watching. We'll see you next time.